magic. I know you're looking for this, so they're not in your way. Multiply, divide, square root, square both sides. Face ten, take a log. Ten, take the action, baby. Hey, operations, they might be crazy.
Welcome to section 10.4. Today we're going to be talking about inverse trig functions. Okay, inverse is everyone's favorite, but we're specifically going to be looking at those trig functions like sine, cosine, and tangent. Just a little recall from the cute little video at the beginning. What are inverses and how do we use them to help us solve equations? Well, inverses are basically opposites of each other. So if we wanted to solve x plus 5 equals 13, we would have to undo the addition of 5, and the opposite of addition would be subtraction. So when we subtract 5 from both sides, we would get 8. Now over here, very similar, to undo the multiplication of 7, we'd have to divide both sides by 7. So x would be 5. Little tricky one here. Okay, we have an exponential, and the inverse of an exponential is a logarithm. Little flashback from unit 7 there. So we would have to take the log with a base of 2 of 24, and that would equal our exponent of x. Little calculator work there, I think it would give us 4.585. So just a little fresher on inverses. And we even have inverses for our trig functions. We want to move the sign over to the other side, that way we can figure out what our angle is. And when we move the sign over, we need to take the inverse of it, just like we did the inverse of addition, the inverse of multiplication, and the inverse of a exponential. So we need to take the inverse sine of 1. Again, some calculator work would give us a value of 90 if you're in degree mode, or maybe pi over 2 if you're in radian mode. So this whole section is going to be about inverse trig functions. We're going to focus on the inverse of sine, the inverse of cosine, and also the inverse of tangent. All right, so let's go ahead and take a look at our first inverse trig function. We're going to focus on the inverse of sine. Now, sometimes you might see it as inverse of sine. That's what this notation means right here, sine to the little negative 1 power. But you also might hear it referred to as what's called arc sine, or written in this particular fashion, arc sine. Arc sine and inverse sine mean the same thing. So regardless of which way you see it, they mean the same idea. Okay, so just a little vocabulary there, arc sine, inverse sine, they're the same thing. Now, normally, we know that the sine of an angle is equal to the ratio of the opposite side of a triangle divided by the hypotenuse of a triangle. So way back when we started our trig, I think in unit 8 it was, we said sine was equal to opposite over hypotenuse. That's where the so part comes from, SOHCAHTOA. But notice how if we were to move the sine to the other side, okay, take the inverse of it, we would then have sine to the negative 1 of this ratio. And since we move it to the other side, our angle is all by itself, or in other words, it equals theta. So you might see the inverse sine written this way, or you might see it written this way. But what we're going to do is try to analyze or take a look at what the inverse sine graph actually looks like, or in other words, that arc sine graph looks like. And since arc sine is directly related to sine itself, the regular trig function, we're going to focus on the original sine graph. So let's go ahead and maybe focus on some key points on our sine curve. We have the origin, which is 0, 0. We have this maximum that occurs at pi over 2 comma 1. We have an x-intercept, or in other words, 0 comma pi. I'm sorry, pi comma 0. Let's get that right, pi comma 0. We have a minimum occurring at 3 pi over 2 comma negative 1. And then we complete our full cycle back at 2 pi. So that'd be 2 pi comma 0. So those are some key points on the original sine graph. Let's take a look at what the inverse sine or the arc sine graph looks like. Now hopefully we remember our inverse rules, and an inverse is simply the idea of switching your variables, or in other words, switching your ordered pairs. So if we were to reverse the order of these ordered pairs, well, 0, 0 really isn't going to change anything. So we still have an ordered pair right there. If we were to reverse the order of our second point, we'd have 1, pi over 2. So let's graph that. We have 1, pi over 2. If we were to reverse the next one, we'd have 0, pi, which would be somewhere right there. And reverse the order again, we had to have negative 1, 3 pi over 2. And we also have 0, 2 pi. So somewhere right there. So notice how if we were to connect our curves, we would still have that sinusoid shape, but instead of kind of being up and down, now it's going left to right. We can even continue the pattern, this wave motion, if you will, all the way through our graph. So it's going to look something like that. So this kind of makes sense because the inverse is just kind of the opposite or switching of our graph. Instead of going left to right, now it's kind of going up and down. But here's what's tricky about the arc sine or inverse sine graph. This is not a function. Notice how it would not pass the vertical line test. Okay, there's no way you can draw a vertical line through the graph and it only touches the graph once. So the fact that this whole graph, if we were to continue or repeat the pattern, is not a function, that means we kind of have to abbreviate it or shorten it into a section that does represent a function. So what we're going to do is kind of erase some of this graph so that only a piece of it is left that is actually a function. So what we're going to do is erase the top portion, kind of right there, and we're going to erase the bottom portion as well. So what we're left with is just this little curve. Okay, notice how now that we are only focusing on this piece, it is representative of a function. It definitely passes the vertical line test. So this is really the only piece of the inverse sine or arc sine graph that we are going to focus on. So this is what you can consider the parent function of an arc sine graph. Okay, so this is the big one right here. Now let's take a look at some of the domain and ranges of this inverse sine graph. Notice how the domain going from left to right is from negative 1 to positive 1, so we can write it as that. And going the range from lowest to highest, we have negative pi over 2 to a positive pi over 2, so that's going to be the range of our arc sine. Now, just like we flipped these variables, notice how our x's originally represented angle measurements, and the y's represented the ratio of the opposite over hypotenuse side. If we're switching these ordered pairs, just like we switch these numbers, we're also switching what they represent. So now these x values actually represent the ratio, and the y values now represent the angle measure. And that's what we're seeing here going on in the domain and range. Notice how the domain or the x values represent that ratio of the opposite over hypotenuse. So the ratio is only going to be stuck between negative 1 and 1, but your angle measure might be stuck between negative pi over 2 and positive pi over 2. So in terms of the unit circle, we're kind of looking inside this first quadrant as well as this fourth quadrant for arc sine, because notice how we can go negative pi over 2 and positive pi over 2. We are considering both options of this sine graph, a positive option as well as a negative option. All right, so let's go ahead and move on to inverse cosine. Just like inverse sine, we kind of had this other way of phrasing it. You could say arc cosine. So inverse cosine and arc cosine, they mean the same exact thing. Again, just a different way of representing it or writing it. So just like sine, cosine in this case is always equal to the ratio of the adjacent side over the hypotenuse. So if we were to move the cosine over, if we were to inverse it with that little negative 1, we would now be taking the inverse cosine of this ratio instead of the original angle that we had before. So when we inverse it, we're now taking the measurement of a ratio of side lengths, no longer an angle measure. So let's try to take a look at what this inverse or arc cosine graph looks like. Again, focusing on the parent cosine graph, let's pick out some key points. It looks like we have 0, 1, pi over 2, 0. We have pi, negative 1, 3 pi over 2, 0. And finally, 2 pi, 1. So if these are on the original cosine graph, we want to inverse them so we can draw our graph, our arc cosine graph. So we're going to flip the ordered pairs. We're now going to have 1, 0. So if we graph that, it's going to be somewhere right there. Then we have 0, pi over 2. So that's somewhere right there. Negative 1, pi right there. 0, 3 pi over 2, somewhere right there. And lastly, we have 1, 2 pi. So somewhere right there. So we have this curve, this sinusoid wave, just like we have over here. Again, you can imagine repeating the pattern, maybe going through another cycle. So if we were, it would look something like this. Again, it's the inverse. Instead of traveling left to right, now it's traveling up and down. Instead of having the radian measures on the x-axis, now we have the radian measures on the y-axis. So inverse, we're just switching the order, flipping things around, and it's all because of that arc cosine, or in this inverse symbol right there. But again, just like the arc sine, notice how the arc cosine is not a function. It does not pass that vertical line test. So what we're going to do is erase a portion of this graph. That way it does represent a function. So let's go ahead and erase maybe the top portion, and we'll erase this bottom portion. So what we're going to do is just focus on this section of the inverse cosine graph. Notice how this represents a function. One thing in, one thing out, passes that vertical line test. So this is considered the parent function of the inverse cosine graph. If you were to graph an arc cosine, this is what you'd have to draw originally. This is considered the original graph. So let's go ahead and take a look at the domain and range. Notice how this little portion, at least in terms of the domain, is trapped between negative 1 and 1. Again, that's representing this ratio of the adjacent side over the hypotenuse, because this is now considered our x value, and the angle is now considered the y value. Now, in terms of that angle, notice how, or at least the range, it goes from an angle measure of 0 radians or 0 degrees all the way up to a measurement of pi, or in other words, 180 degrees. So in terms of the unit circle, we can see how that is related. Notice how an angle of 0 would be right here, but an angle of pi would land us on the other side. And since we're focusing on cosine, cosine is positive in this first quadrant, and also it's actually negative in the second quadrant. So just like sine, we're focusing on a positive portion and a negative portion of this arc cosine graph. All right, last but not least, let's go ahead and take a look at arctangent, or inverse tangent. Tangent, the original trig function, is equal to the opposite side over the adjacent side. But when we move the tangent function to the other side, when we got to take that inverse, now we're taking the tangent of a ratio. We're no longer taking the tangent of an angle. Okay, so we're kind of flipping the order, just like an inverse tells us. We switch the x and y variable. Again, inverse tan and arctan, they mean the same thing. They just might be written differently, but again, they mean the same thing. So let's take a look at what the inverse tangent graph looks like, and to help us graph it, we're going to use the original tangent. So again, let's try to pick some key points here, and it might be useful to use kind of these x-intercepts to help us out. It looks like we have negative pi, 0, 0 comma 0 and pi comma 0 as well. So if we were to find those inverse points, flipping the order, our ordered pairs will look something like this. So let's go ahead and graph those points. We have 0 comma negative pi, 0 comma 0, and 0 comma pi somewhere right there. Now there's also a key characteristic on the tangent graph, and that is the asymptotes that actually show up, because sine and cosine really don't have asymptotes, so we don't have to worry about those, but tangent does. So let's take a look at these asymptotes. This asymptote over here occurs at negative 3 pi over 2, but if we were to inverse it, instead of being a vertical line on the x-axis, it's now going to be a horizontal line on the inverse, meaning somewhere right there. And this asymptote is going to behave the same way. Instead of being at negative pi vertically, it's now at negative pi horizontally. We can do the same thing for these other asymptotes going across our graph. So really this should help us kind of visualize what our curve is going to look like. Instead of these curves going up and down, just like our vertical asymptotes did, they're now going to go left to right, just like our asymptotes are now horizontal. So we're going to have kind of a graph that looks like this, going left to right. But again, after we draw a few cycles, okay, a few of these little sections of our inverse trig graph, notice how it is not a function, okay? It does not pass the vertical line test. So just like the other ones, we're going to have to erase a portion of this graph. Really, this goes forever up and forever down, but since it's not a function, we're only going to focus on a particular piece of it. So let's go ahead and erase this first curve that I drew. And we'll erase the bottom curve that I drew. We'll just focus on the one in the middle, the one that starts at the origin. So notice how if we only focus on this piece, it is a function. It passes that vertical line test. If you were to drag your pencil across the graph, it would only touch once. So this is the parent function, the original graph of our inverse tangent or arctangent. So if this is the graph we're going to focus on, let's go ahead and take a look at the domain and the range. In terms of the domain, how far left we can go, how far right we can go, it's all real numbers because we have those arrows. So this ratio of opposite side over the adjacent side, it could be anything. It doesn't have to be trapped between negative 1 and 1 like sine and cosine had to be. Okay, this ratio can be absolutely anything. So any ratio, any real number would work in this case. But if we look at the range, notice how we go from negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2. So that is the range of the angle measures that we're going to have in our trig function. And if we're focusing on tangent, tangent is positive in this first quadrant, and it is also negative in the fourth quadrant, which is exactly what's going on here in the range. We could go down pi over 2 in that negative direction, but we could also go up pi over 2 in that positive direction. All right, so let's go ahead and take a look at a few examples that involve some of these arc or inverse trig functions. For the first one, we want to find the exact value of the expression in degrees and radians without the use of a calculator. Okay, so we're going to try to do this old school. We're going to do this in our heads. So we're going to take the tangent of the arc sine of the square root of 3 over 2. Okay, mind boggled right there. But let's just focus on one piece at a time. Okay, we normally order of operations tells us to work inside parentheses or grouping symbols first. So let's go ahead and just take a look at this piece. Arc sine of the square root of 3 over 2. Now remember, arc sine and the inverse sine mean the same thing. So if you really want to write arc sine as sine to the negative first, you absolutely can. So let's just take a look at this piece. This is representative of the ratio of the sides of a right triangle. But whatever this equals should be an angle measure. So we got to figure out what angle measure has a sine value of the square root of 3 over 2. So this is where knowing your unit circle is crucial. Okay, you need to know the unit circle to help you with these, especially if you're going to use or you're not going to use a calculator. So what angle measure gives us a value of square root of 3 over 2 when we're using the sine of that angle. Well, if you got to look at your unit circle, go ahead. But remember, we really got to embed this in our brain. That particular angle is 60 degrees. So really, the inverse sine of the square root of 3 over 2 is equal to 60 degrees. So that's why I'm just rewriting this as 60 instead of this arc sine function. But we want to take the tangent of whatever this is. So we want to take the tangent of 60. Again, you need to know your unit circle. So if we think about tangent, remember tangent is that opposite over adjacent, or in other words, tangent is sine over cosine, okay, meaning the same thing. So at this point on our unit circle, at 60 degrees, what is the sine value and the cosine value, the exact values for that particular angle? Well, the sine value is the square root of 3 over 2, okay, just like how we saw here. And the cosine value is 1 over 2. Again, we're looking at those ordered pairs, those exact values. So let's see if we can simplify this. Instead of dividing by a fraction, we can multiply by the reciprocal. So we get 2 square roots of 3 over 2, but the 2's can cancel, and all we're left with is the square root of 3. So this beast that we solved here, the tangent of the arc sine of the square root of 3 over 2, is actually equal to the square root of 3. Again, baby steps, work from the inside out, and you need to know your unit circle. All right, now for example number 2 here, let's use a reference triangle to find the exact value. Okay, so we're going to find the tangent of the inverse sine of 5 over 13. So since we're using the inverse sine, sine is the opposite over the hypotenuse. All right, so let's draw a reference triangle here. We'll say this is our angle. So the opposite side of that angle is 5, the hypotenuse is 13. We want to find the tangent. Okay, so the tangent of this angle should be equal to the opposite over the adjacent. So let's go ahead and try to find that particular ratio. We know the opposite is 5, but we need to figure out the adjacent. So let's go ahead and maybe use Pythagorean's theorem to help us figure out what this side is. That is a squared plus b squared equals c squared. So we have 5 squared plus b squared, that's what we're trying to find here, equals 13 squared. We can subtract 25 over to give us 144, and square root gives us 12. So the b value here, this side length, is actually 12. Which means if we're trying to find the tangent, the ratio of opposite over adjacent, we would have 5 over 12. All right, so what we're going to do is kind of look at an extension of these inverse trig functions. We know normally that we take the sine, cosine, or tangent of an angle, and that is equal to the ratio of the sides of the triangle. So particularly in sine, we have the opposite over hypotenuse. But when we take an inverse function, these values switch. Okay, we're switching our variables. So now the ratio is actually the independent variable. That's what we're taking the sine of now, and the angle is what it's actually equal to. Okay, inverses, we switch the position, we switch our variables. We can also take inverses, actually, of our reciprocal trig functions. So we know cosecant is 1 over sine. But again, in terms of that ratio, instead of opposite over hypotenuse, it is hypotenuse over opposite. So really, this ratio is what we would be taking of an inverse cosecant function here. But we really don't have inverse cosecant, inverse secant, or inverse tangent available on our calculators. So what we have to do is convert this inverse cosecant into an inverse sine. And how we do that is really simple, actually just flipping the order of the ratio. So inverse secant, we say, is related to inverse sine. And instead of taking the ratio of hypotenuse over opposite, sine, after all, involves opposite over hypotenuse. So notice how we can change a reciprocal inverse trig function into a regular inverse trig function, and that would give us our angle measure in the end. Okay, so if you're dealing with a reciprocal inverse trig function, just relate it to the actual trig function that it is derived from. So cosecant is 1 over sine, so we can relate cosecant inverse to sine inverse. So let's go ahead and take a look at some examples here actually involving those reciprocal trig functions. So we know that cosecant is representative of hypotenuse over opposite. So that's exactly what this is representing. If you want to, we should actually write it as a ratio or a fraction. So we could say 2.67 over 1. So in this particular triangle, whatever it might be, the hypotenuse is 2.67 and the opposite side has a value of 1. But we can't really type this into our calculator. We don't have this inverse cosecant option. So we have to convert it into sine, or in other words, that inverse sine. So instead of writing this as hypotenuse over opposite, we should flip it, because sine, after all, is opposite over hypotenuse. So now that we've related cosecant to sine, we can type this into our calculator. It's really hard to tell from here if we should use radians or degrees, so I'll let you kind of decide what you want to do, because after all, this is equaling an angle. So I'll let you decide if you want to use radians or degrees, but if you were to use degrees, it should be about 22 degrees. All right, so let's check this one out. Now notice how this one is not an inverse, okay? So secant in this case, this value right here is representing an angle, okay? When we're dealing with inverses, the inside piece is representing the ratio. So there is a difference. If we have an inverse, the number is representing a ratio. If we don't have an inverse, the number is actually representing an angle. And notice how 0.15, if this is an angle that does not have a little degree symbol, that means we should be working in radians. So we can actually use our calculator to help us with this. Secant is 1 over cosine. So if we were to type 1 over cosine of 0.15, make sure our calculator's in radian mode, we should get 1.01. So if this was our angle measure we're specifically focusing on, that means this answer is the ratio of the sides. So we would have 1.01 would be representative of the hypotenuse. And if it's over 1, that would be representative of the adjacent side, because we're dealing with cosine. All right, so what I want to do finally is take a look at an example of a scenario that would involve these inverse trig functions. And because you are going to see one of these, I think, in either the practice or the application. So let's go ahead and look at one together now while we have the chance. A photographer wants to photo a hot air balloon launch. Let's write an equation to model the angle of his camera. Okay, in other words, that's kind of like the angle of elevation, as a function of the height s of the balloon. So the balloon is rising, okay, it's launching into the air, and we have our little balloon right there. So notice how we're focusing on this angle of elevation, and we're also focusing on the height of the balloon itself. Now they go on to tell us here that the distance between the camera, at least on the ground, to the hot air balloon is 500 feet. So let's take a look at a trig going on here. What would we use when we know the opposite side and the adjacent side? Well, that would be tangent. So the tangent of this angle of elevation should equal the height of the balloon, s, that's the opposite side, over the length, or the distance, of 500, because that's the adjacent side. But it says to write an equation to model the angle. So we want to get the angle all by itself. What would this angle equal? Well, in order to get the angle all by itself, we would have to move over the tangent function. So if we're going to move the tangent function over, we have to use the inverse. So we have s over 500. So there's our function. There is our equation. Let's go ahead and graph it, or at least take a look at what it might look like on a graphing calculator. So let's bring that up. Now let's see. We'll type in the inverse tangent of x, because that's our variable, over 500. And before we hit graph, let's go ahead and make sure our degree we're in degree mode. So we'll hit the mode button and I'm good to go. Okay, so we're good there. And let's go ahead and take a look at our window. Okay, so the x's, okay, this independent variable right now, or in other words, our x-axis, is going to be representing our height, because that's where our s is. So all of these values down here are going to be heights of this balloon. Now, how far do we think this balloon is actually going to go in the air? I don't really know. I'm just going to take a stab and guess 1,000. I mean, we can always change this, okay, but for now, I'm just going to guess 1,000, which means that our answer, our independent or dependent variable, I'm sorry, is theta. How big do you think this angle is going to be? Well, clearly it might be zero, like a really, I guess one maybe would be really small, really small angle. And as the camera goes up, the angle is increasing. So clearly, if the balloon was directly over the camera itself, notice how that angle would be 90. So we're really not going to go past 90 degrees. I'm going to go ahead and set that as my max. So looking at our window, we can go from 0 to 1,000. I mean, we can always change that if we have to. And then our y-axis will go from 0 to 90 because that would mean that the balloon is directly over the camera itself. So if we hit graph, let's take a look and see what's going on here. Notice how the distance or the height of the balloon, as the height increases, so does the angle. And that makes sense because as the balloon goes up in the air, the angle is going to have to increase as well in order to capture the picture of the balloon. So if we want to basically draw a rough sketch of that, looks like something like that. Really rough sketch. But in order to answer the question, I mean, you can answer a lot of questions now that you have an equation here, but the basic one here was to write an equation. So we started with tangent, but since it was asking for an equation in terms of theta, in terms of that angle, we had to move the tangent over specifically using that inverse trig function. So good luck on the practice and the application and that mastery check. I'll see you guys later. Hey, quick second here. Really pay attention to the clip I'm about to show you. I think it's really cool. It's about all these different pendulums, and we have these different shapes swinging back and forth. But that's because they have different periods. Okay, their cycles are repeating at different rates. I think it's really cool. I hope you enjoy it as well.